done with the food, really, you know. It's too much plastic.
Just pretend I can swim.
The only reason I'm still doing this job is because of
big problem was my eyes at one stage. I went in about my eyes on a lot of work.
God help the people
who
have crisis.
Yeah, they can't.
That's something I hadn't really considered that they're appearing on television.
Aardman Animations may now be better known for their work with the cheese-obsessed Wallace and his trusty canine companion Gromit. The founder members David Sproxton and Peter Lord spent their formative years with the company producing a series of groundbreaking films animating real-life conversations.
Oh, hello, lady. I brought my sunshine for you. How's that? Isn't that nice to be have a sunny day like this, isn't it?
When we started doing this kind of vox-pop, found sound documentary recording stuff, Pete and I would sit with, you know, a tape recorder, and as we sat and listened and scribbled away, you realise that people, they don't necessarily say what they mean to say, but you understand what they mean. And you have this kind of communication, imperfection, stumbling thing, but it's real. They are real people. And I think that's part of the appeal.
I haven't got any money, that's right.
I know. What do I,
but, skin.
And the people who have are not very happy sometimes, are they?
I was a student at the time, and I remember talking to my dad on the phone saying, have you seen this new series on the TV? You won't believe it. It's this plasticine figures. And they've got such soul and such warmth and character. You know, the humanity is just amazing. And even though it was really crudely done, and I think Pete and David admit that, but there was a real warmth and humanity in there.
Nick Park joined the company in 1986 as a film school graduate to finish off his first Wallace and Gromit film, A Grand Day Out. He was also asked to produce a piece for a new series of animated conversations. The resulting film was entitled Creature Comforts.
Yeah, well, it's reasonably comfortable, I suppose, this place, but... I've been in more comfortable rooms, yes.
Well, sometimes you can't get out and about as much as you would like to.
I had to find people who might be in the same situation that animals might be in to give the kinds of answers animals might give. So, went to old people's homes to chose like people, foreign people living in Bristol, how they cope with the cold weather and the food and all that kind of thing.
If you try to compare the situations and the environment that you live here with the environment that you live in Brazil, there is a big difference. Here, you live in a very small place.
It was a magical moment. I remember this day, syncing up, the first piece that Nick shot was the Jaguar on the log. Suddenly that magic happened, and here was this Jaguar absolutely expounding about what he thought of England and the wet weather and Brazil and the food and that, central heating and stuff.
Animation director Richard Dolly-Joski, affectionately known as Dolly, was responsible for some of Aardman's most recent successes, including the award-winning series, Rex the Runt.
Catchy mouse.
His long association with Aardman and his groundbreaking animation work have earned him the monumental task of breathing new life into Creature Comforts as director on the series.
Golly seemed the best choice, really. You know, we worked together on the original one way back in 1989. If anyone, he was the guy who was going to understand the process.
I think there's something unique about real conversation in that it's like I'm doing now, it kind of stutters and stammers around, it's nervous, it's tentative, it's sometimes people don't say exactly what they mean.
At the moment,
I'm searching, you know what I mean?
Not real.
Maybe one day I'll just wake up and think, I have evolved.
One day we're thinking you got there, the next minute you get run over.
That's it, game over. You know what I mean?
Do you think Jesus was an astronaut?
He's from another planet.
My wife and I holiday annually in Cornwall.
I guess I naturally want to start frolicking. And I think
gathering
that
interviews
must,
with the general
that
public
mean that,
was the starting
know,
point
so
for
we,
the series.
We,
interviewers
I think we're more
were dispatched
like
to all corners of the country
land,
to get as broad a spectrum of accents and ages as possible.
I don't know, really. I haven't ever really given it much thought.
Yeah, where did you get these questions from?
It's a bit like panning for gold, or it's a bit like going on an adventure. You're going to get blown off track a bit. You don't know quite what territories you're going to go through, because simply, until that material comes in, you've got no idea. You might guide it through the way you interview people, but really how you're going to form it, it's just a blank sheet when you start. It's not like you've got a written script.
And every now and again...
And the worst thing that happens is just there's too many people each.
You start with some themes in mind for each episode, but you don't tie yourself down to them, because the material we got back from people is what shaped the series. So it kind of works both ways, because I'm also thinking of it would be funny if you had a maggot sat on a fish hook saying that you liked fishing or you liked the Norfolk Broads and it was nice here.
You can't be morbid, or you wouldn't be able to do the work. You've got to have a laugh and a joke, you know.
Well, a lot of them see it as a form of therapy, actually. By the end of it, they're shaking your hand and saying, thanks, that was amazing, I've got a lot off my chest.
OK. Right. Nice to have spoken to you anyway.
So you're not actually asking anybody to give you the right answer to anything, you're just asking for their opinion.
And I don't like the music, that... Oh, that horrible roundabout music with... Oh, no, ooh, clowns aren't not my...
There aren't any rules, it's kind of anybody might do, but anybody might not do.
I might be very loyal, but I do like my father said before me. He said, you trust everybody once.
A boring voice, for example, can be very boring, but it can also be funny because it's boring as well.
So I'm loyal to the point of disloyalty.
Not that many voices I've listened to naturally throw up a character, but the best ones do. Somebody might sound a bit like a horse, or they've got somebody that sounds like a hamster.
Not very good at swimming. I just sink. Don't know why that is.
I had octopus once when we were... I didn't know it was octopus, mind.
Oh, very tough, isn't it?
Yes.
Very tough.
Yes. But I ate it, I'm saying.
See, when you really listen to conversation, it is fantastic. It's so rich, because everybody's their own script writer. And if you've got a dialogue, or three or four people in a pub or cafe or home, they've all got their own angle, and they've all got their own train of thought which they're trying to pursue.
I can't even juggle.
Well, can I? I juggle with two things, but not with three.
It's not really juggling, is it?
No, it's chucking stuff up in the air, isn't it?
Yeah.
You're looking for clues. Like, for instance, we've got a character that, while he was being interviewed, was interrupted by his mother. And you can hear in the background coming through the door, he says, can I help you, mother? Yeah, do you want something? And she says something, and he says...
Just go back in your little...
So we made him a worm, you know, because that was... just seemed appropriate from what was being said.
But then, yeah, the beginning of the season... you might not have enough snow, which is quite frustrating. And then at the end...
300 interviews generate 500 to 600 hours of material to listen to, and that's a huge mountain to climb, considering there is only one director.
Snow, turning it into slush.
Could be a bull.
And then that gets really...
Might be quite good.
Especially one with skis.
Yeah.
Or it could be a bat, because we haven't had a bat yet.
The best voices quite difficult, because you realise that if you've got a really good recording with lots of great juicy lines in it, that they could be several animals, so you then have to use the one that you can kind of use the most, or get the most laughs, or be the most appropriate.
Each day I can run, touch wood with...
The greyhound went from, you know, being a bee at one stage to a bird, back to a bee again.
We're tired from racing. I don't even like to think about it. I feel it.
Just kind of so laboured in the way that he had his interview that every time we got into the meat of his answer, we kind of wanted to stop him. And that's where Golly kind of came up with this idea that he could be this greyhound that never finished his sentence.
I feel that if I've given my best performance and it's a good one, then obviously I get the reward, the pat on the back, knowing that you've tried to do your best for your coach. They've given you the training. The least you can do.
You listen to the voice and you've got an idea, and it's really nice to see the pictures come up against the voice to see what's working. And
Mike is Nick's representative on Earth, so I trust him a lot.
It's quite posh, this bloke, isn't it?
Yes, it's yard.
I always go home.
Listen to the voice, and then you have a few ideas, a few sketches up your sleeves, and the more info I can get to go on, the better, yeah. And then I sort of... And that's kind of a sort of rough idea and sort of sketch it out.
Almost like an Aryan bull, like a muscular... they're very laid back as well, that's the important thing. That's, and holding a glass of wine, like a wine taster, sort of from the base.
Right,
I wanted him to kind of look at the wine while he's talking. And a very sort of elegant barn conversion in the background.
As to whether they visited us or not, recently.
While the character's being designed... built. We're also sitting in a room and doing live action video recordings.
I think that was something which I felt a bit bemused by that.
Yes. Mainly, I just watched Jeremy Paxman.
You know, dogs have got... They've got
either myself or the animators talking through the line to get the most out of that line, to try and get to that, like I said, the emotional truth behind what's actually being said. You know, is he telling the truth? Is he kind of slightly embarrassed to be asked that question? We try to get to as much depth as we can with each line.
Because the dog's appealing to his owner. You know, he's kind of given up trying to drop hints and trying to get the owner to react. Don't, so it's like lots of treats.
And that's the point where we decide how the creature's going to be animated. It's trying to find that human element in what's being said. That's the bit I enjoy most.
The best thing to do an impression of a stick.
Stupid.
Are you happy with that?
Yeah, I'm happy with that. I just realised that there's the stick insects haven't got a great deal of expression because they're very kind of thin characters, two eyes and a little flappy mouth, so I was just wondering about an eyebrow is very useful normally on a character because you can get a variety of expression, but we can't really do that with these sticks, but we might sort of do some squash and stretch on the eyes.
And it's very hard to have to suddenly switch from listening to voices to sound in characters and then going into the set and thinking how a shot should work, but doing a rehearsal with them in live action, then approving a shot, and then wondering how that fits in the edit. And all of this happens in one day.
People say we should be getting awards for sheer numbers of puppets made. I think we've made 150 plus speaking characters, and then there's lots of background characters and the walk-ons, and the, you know, sometimes Scully will just kind of call for, oh, can we have a ladybird walking in the background for tomorrow morning? So we'll chuck in a few of those as well. Simple style. I mean, there's certain kind of set things that, like having that kind of heavy brow, that makes things very expressive, and the eyes close together, usually kind of slightly cross-eyed.
I think you get more out of the dog in response.
Well, they're more interesting, aren't they?
I think they're thicker than cats, personally.
That kind of big mouth shape seems to work very well with Yorkshire and Lancashire accents. It doesn't work on all the characters, and we kind of try to tailor the mouths and the way the mouth works to the different kinds of voices as well.
Yeah, you see, I've had a lot of things wrong with me.
We wouldn't sit next to someone that had radios blaring out and were really being loud and everything. I think if they came and sat next to us, we'd move.
It's either the bull terrier or the bulldog can hardly breathe.
So sorry.
Originally, when Nick Park was animating Creature Comforts, he used to sculpt through the mouths, which meant that literally that you'd just take the mouth, and if you wanted to open it, you would just literally open it up a little bit, smooth it off, take a shot, move it a bit more, smooth it off, take a shot, and it's a really long process. And more recently, we've developed a process where you can actually take the mouth off and put a different expression back on again.
Thank you.
this shoot, we would have done 120 different setups. And within that, you've got slugs, which might be this big, to a dog, which is this big. So each different setup will need different size props.
I've got this, which is the visual, and we have the puppets for the main characters already sculpted. I know how big they are. And then we're going to force the perspective of it and make the characters behind smaller than the characters in front. We just need to know how much smaller, and then how big the set's going to be before we can start making it.
The size of the puppet which an animator can animate dictates the scale of the set. This is the pet shop set. And what's slightly different about this is all built full scale. So it has to be lit full scale. And this is the outside of the pet shop. If we built him full scale, he'd be something like a couple of hundred weight of plasticine and nobody could move him. So he's quarter scale. And the lighting appropriately has to be quarter scale as well.
I don't catch flies because they eat pearl.
I don't catch flies.
What I'm doing here is breaking the sound down into phonetic shapes, then allocating those to a dope sheet so that the animators get their mouth shapes in the right place, basically, so that the lip sync is tight, because that's really important to me. I can't stand shoddy lip sync, there's no need for it. So here, you can hear the P coming in there, and there's the P of poo. Down to that point. And then if you listen in the end, there's just a little breath there that the child takes before the track cuts out. So I also tell the animator when the puppet is supposed to be breathing. Breathe in.
I went to a friend's last weekend.
The things that make the creatures seem very human are just the things that people do. I love the thing. That's great. Sniffs or even breathing in, if you can incorporate those details into the animal, you kind of almost believe it's alive. You know, I still do, and I've been doing it for 20 years.
I really enjoy working with people that have got...
Great. It's great, it's really, you've got the character.
I really look forward to going to work because...
Each puppet or each character is going to be slightly different because they'll do more nervous things when they're on TV or, you know, being recorded, so they might stutter, they might go like that, so you can overemphasize that. The lady herself, she's partially blind, so it's ironic that she's doing a guide dog, but I think that's the cute and loveliness about it, I suppose. Yeah, she's a good voice to animate with.
With people that have got difficulties.
You hear the voice, and Golly will kind of tell you what he has in mind. So I don't know what this guy really looks like, but in my mind, he's a Ginger Tom, so that's what I think he is.
I've got a lovely smile, Truman says. So, I look good for my age too.
I think animators are a strange hybrid between a director and an actor, in that they're making a puppet perform, but it's their performance through the puppets. They're directing their scene in terms of being aware of what else is happening in that scene.
She's a bit silly. I'm sure she's not in real life. And he gets irritated by her sometimes. And he's so lazy. He's just great because he's so lazy with his slow eyelids and slow mannerisms.
We're trying to shoot on average per animator about 4 seconds per day. Say like the cat and the dog. Two characters all both speaking at the same time, quite a bit of action, full lip sync. You know, will only take 2 seconds a day maximum, maybe three if you're lucky, if there's a lot of pauses.
This particular character's just talking about his friends in the neighbourhood and how they all get together, you know, and sort of when the weather's really, really dry. This is probably the only pond in the neighbourhood.
There aren't many ponds in the neighbourhood.
I'm animating all of them at the moment. This particular one's sort of just exercising, one in the back sort of fanning, and this one's just turning around to engage with this one.
Because of the process, you find yourself kind of looking at people when they're talking, and you're kind of more aware of those details actually happening in front of your eyes for real, you know.
I don't really enjoy proper.
He's actually quite simple, this one. So he's on the winder underneath the set, and he just moves up and down. No arms, no legs. The worst one were two shrimps, and for each two frames, I had to move 36 separate items.
I'm an excellent swimmer, and I've got loads of badges, and I've won a few competitions. I've got life-saving awards and all sorts of badges.
An important element of creature comforts is its plasticine. I can make one of those.
I think the reason we still use plasticine, and probably always will, is because you can be so expressive with it. I think that's the great thing about creature comforts, is that, you know, it's not about action and editing, and it's more about giving a space for a character just to develop.
The imperfection of, you know, human conversation is reflected in the imperfection of the way that we animate it. It is kind of more real. It's not been edited out to smoothness and perfection.
Plasticine kind of reveals the process of animation, whereas maybe other drawn animation or CGI don't.
The bottom line is we never sunbathe.
English was very bland, isn't it?
The best place for rock pooling is definitely Sidmouth.
I've been chased by an old English shooting dog.
I think I'm an oddity. I've got a foot in both camps, really.
I think we've evolved to our full potential.
I used to be a chaser myself.
Some days I can move, mate. It's the next day I can't do anything.
I've got a windy stomach.
Chip butties.
Sterile waters somewhere, and the volcanic chemicals and all that.
Shut up.
It does highlight, in a way, the humanity of people. Their care for each other, the way they think about the world, the way they think about their lives.
I find that people are saying opinions that you never really ever see in documentaries, because there isn't the platform or the idea to express those things.
It's just just finding that kind of emotional truth in what people say, and I think people recognise that.
Teamwork. That's one thing about it I like. I wouldn't like to work on my own.
It's over 100, isn't it?
Well, it used to be than 200.
We've lost quite a few.
People say things that are very revealing about themselves, and I think there is a mixture of tragedy and comedy in creature comforts. You know, the revealing of very kind of personal things.
I always wanted a shed all my life. And now I've got one.
To read pornography in.
Not to read pornography.
It's a really funny kind of hybrid thing that's come about, really, because I'm not sure of the ethics of it at all, you know, of using people in this way. You know, it's an odd thing. And then making them into animals.
I can't do anything with anybody's feet. After all, I'm doing anything with my own, and sputum really makes my stomach turn over.
Yeah, what the heck? You know, it's funny.
I like the hamster. I feel an empathy with the hamster because it sounds like he doesn't leave the house much. I think he's great. I'd love to meet him.
And I like the cat and the dog on the sofa. There's the guide dog. The slugs are one of my favourites, actually. I love the dogs in the skip, though. They're great. Actually, I love also the sea anemones and the hamster, actually.